Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents New Laws of Robotics, Defending Human Expertise in the Age of AI, by Frank Pasquale, narrated by Perry Daniels. Education is the point at which we decide whether we love the world enough to assume responsibility for it, and by the same token, save it from that ruin which, except for renewal, except for the coming of the new and young, would be inevitable. And education, too, is where we decide whether we love our children enough not to expel them from our world and leave them to their own devices, nor to strike from their hands their chance of undertaking something new, something unforeseen by us, but to prepare them in advance for the task of renewing a common world. Hannah Arendt, Between Past and Future. I am speaking of a law now, understand, that point at which bodies locked in cages become ontology, the point at which structures of cruelty, force, war become ontology. The analog is what I believe in. The reconstruction of the phenomenology of perception not according to a machine, more now for the imagination to affix to than ever before. Lawrence Joseph, in parentheses. 1. Introduction. The stakes of technological advance rise daily. Combine facial recognition databases with ever-cheapening micro-drones, and you have an anonymous global assassination force of unprecedented precision and lethality. What can kill can also cure. Robots could vastly expand access to medicine if we invested more in researching and developing them. Businesses are taking thousands of small steps toward automating hiring, customer service, and even management. All these developments change the balance between machines and humans in the ordering of our daily lives. Avoiding the worst outcomes in the artificial intelligence, AI, revolution, while capitalizing on its potential, will depend on our ability to cultivate wisdom about this balance. To that end, this book advances three arguments that stand to improve all our lives. The first is empirical. Right now, AI and robotics most often complement rather than replace human labor. The second proposes a value. In many areas, we should maintain this status quo. And the final point is a political judgment. Our institutions of governance are actually capable of achieving exactly that outcome. Here is this book's most basic premise. We now have the means to channel technologies of automation rather than being captured or transformed by them. These ideas will strike many as commonsensical. Why write an entire book to defend them? Because they have some surprising implications, which should change how we organize social cooperation and deal with conflict. For example, at present, too many economies favor capital over labor, and consumers over producers. If we want a just and sustainable society, we must correct these biases. That correction will not be easy. Ubiquitous management consultants tell a simple story about the future of work. If a machine can record and imitate what you do, you will be replaced by it. A narrative of mass unemployment now grips policymakers. It envisions human workers rendered superfluous by even more powerful software, robots, and predictive analytics. With enough cameras and sensors, this story goes, managers can simulate your data double, a hologram or robot that performs your job just as well at a fraction of your wages. This vision offers stark alternatives. Make robots or get replaced by them. Another story is possible, and indeed, more plausible. In virtually every walk of life, robotic systems can make labor more valuable, not less. This book tells the story of doctors, nurses, teachers, home health aides, journalists, and others who work with roboticists and computer scientists, rather than meekly serving as data sources for their future replacements. Their cooperative relationships prefigure the kind of technological advance that could bring better healthcare, education, and more to all of us, while maintaining meaningful work. They also show how law and public policy can help us achieve peace and inclusive prosperity, rather than a race against the machines. But we can only do so if we update the laws of robotics that guide our vision of technological progress. Asimov's Laws of Robotics. In the 1942 short story, Runaround, the science fiction writer Isaac Asimov delineated three laws of machines that could sense their environment, process information, and then act. The story introduces a Handbook of Robotics, 56th edition, from 2058, that commands, number 1, a robot may not injure a human being or, through inaction, allow a human being to come to harm. Number 2, a robot must obey the orders given to it by human beings, except where such orders would conflict with the first law. Number 3, a robot must protect its own existence as long as such protection does not conflict with the first or second laws. Asimov's laws of robotics have been enormously influential. They seem clear-cut, but they are not easy to apply. Can an autonomous drone blast a terrorist cell? The first half of the first law, a robot may not injure a human being, seems to forbid such an action. But a soldier might quickly invoke the second half of the first law, forbidding inaction that would allow a human being to come to harm. To determine which half of the law should apply, we must look at other values. The ambiguities do not stop at the battlefield. Consider, for instance, whether Asimov's laws allow robotic cars. Self-driving vehicles promise to eliminate many thousands of traffic fatalities each year, so the problem may seem easy at first glance. On the other hand, they would also put hundreds of thousands of paid drivers out of work. Does that harm entitle governments to ban or slow down the adoption of self-driving cars? Asimov's three laws are not clear on such matters, nor do they have much to say about a recent demand of self-driving car evangelists, that pedestrians be trained to act in ways that make it easier for self-driving vehicles to operate and penalized if they fail to do so. These ambiguities, and many more, are why the statutes, regulations, and court cases affecting robotics and AI in our world are finer-grained than Asimov's laws. We will explore much of that legal landscape in the course of the book. But before doing so, I want to introduce four new laws of robotics to animate our explorations ahead. They are directed to the people building robots, not to robots themselves. And although they are more ambiguous than Asimov's, they also better reflect how actual lawmaking is accomplished. Because legislators cannot possibly anticipate every situation that authorities may need to address, they often empower agencies with broadly worded statutes. New laws of robotics should be similar, articulated broad principles while delegating specific authority to dedicated regulators with long experience in technical fields. New laws of robotics. With these goals in mind, four new laws of robotics will be explored and advanced in this book. Number 1. Robotic systems and AI should complement professionals, not replace them. Clashing projections of technological unemployment drive popular discussions of the future of work. Some experts predict that almost every job is destined to be whittled away by technological advance. Others point out roadblocks on the path to automation. The question for policymakers is, which of these barriers to robotization makes sense, and which deserves scrutiny and removal? Robotic meat cutters make sense. Robotic daycare gives us pause. Is the latter caution mere Luddite reaction, or is it reflective of a deeper wisdom about the nature of childhood? Licensure rules now keep symptom-analyzing apps from being marketed as physicians practicing medicine. Is this good policy? This book analyzes such examples and marshals both empirical and normative arguments for slowing down or speeding up the adoption of AI in varied fields. Numerous factors matter, specific to jobs and jurisdictions. But one unitary organizing principle is the importance of meaningful work to the self-worth of people and the governance of communities. A humane agenda for automation would prioritize innovations that complement workers in jobs that are, or ought to be, fulfilling vocations. It would substitute machines to do dangerous or degrading work, while ensuring those presently doing that work are fairly compensated for their labor and offered a transition to other social roles. This balanced stance will disappoint both technophiles and technophobes. So too will the emphasis on governance alienate both those who object to interference in labor markets and others who loathe a professional managerial class. To the extent professions amount to an economic caste system, unfairly privileging some workers over others, their suspicions are justified. However, it is possible to soften stratification while promoting professions' higher aims. The bargain at the core of professionalism is to empower workers to have some say in the organization of production, while imposing duties upon them to advance the common good. By advancing research, whether in divisions of universities or in their own offices, professionals cultivate a distributed expertise, alleviating classic tensions between technocracy and popular rule. We should not be dismantling or disabling professions, as all too many advocates of disruptive innovation aspire to do. Rather, humane automation will require the strengthening of existing communities of expertise and the creation of new ones. A good definition of professions is capacious, and it should include many unionized workers, particularly when they protect those they serve from unwise or dangerous technologies. For instance, teachers' unions have protested excessive drilling and testing via automated systems and have promoted their students' interests in many other contexts. Unions that tend toward a path of professionalization, empowering their members to protect those they serve, should have an important role in shaping the AI revolution. Sometimes it will be difficult to demonstrate that a human-centered process is better than an automated one. Crude monetary metrics crowd out complex critical standards. For example, machine learning programs may soon predict, based on brute force natural language processing, whether one book proposal is more likely than another to be a bestseller. From a purely economic perspective, such programs may be better than editors or directors at picking manuscripts or film scripts. Nevertheless, those in creative industries should stand up for their connoisseurship. Editors have an important role in publishing, exercising judgment, and finding and promoting work that the public may not now want, but needs. The same could be said of journalists. Even if automated text generation could generate ad-maximizing copy, that hollow triumph should never replace genuine reporting from an authentic, hard-won human point of view. Professional schools and universities clarify and re-examine standards in media, law, medicine, and many other fields, preventing them from collapsing into metrics simple enough to be automated. Even in fields that seem most subject to the automation imperative, in areas like logistics, cleaning, agriculture, and mining, workers will play a critical role in a long transition to AI and robotics. Gathering or creating the data necessary for AI will be a demanding task for many. Regulations can make their jobs more rewarding and self-directed. For example, European privacy law empowers drivers to resist the kind of 360-degree surveillance and control that oppresses truckers in the United States. That is not to say that such a dangerous occupation should go unmonitored. Sensors may indicate problems with a driver's reflexes. But there is a world of difference between sensors specifically aimed at safety lapses and a constant video and audio recording of all actions. Getting the balance right between unnerving and demeaning surveillance and sensible, focused monitoring will be crucial in a wide range of fields. We can also design technological transitions that keep human beings in the picture, or at least give them that choice. For example, Toyota has promoted cars with a spectrum of machine involvement, from chauffeur mode, which requires minimal monitoring by a driver, to guardian mode, which focuses the car's computing systems on accident avoidance while a person helms the vehicle. Planes have had autopilot capacities for decades, but commercial carriers still tend to have at least two people in the cockpit. Even the occasional airline passenger can be grateful that the evangelists of substitutive automation are in no hurry to jettison pilots. Note, too, that transportation is one of the easier cases for AI. Once a destination is set, there is no argument over the point of a trip. In other service fields, the opposite is true. The customer's or client's mind may change. A class may be too antsy on a beautiful spring day to practice multiplication tables repeatedly. A socialite may call his interior designer, worried that the print they chose for the living room is too brash. A trainer may vacillate, worried that her client is too exhausted to run another minute on a treadmill. In each of these cases, communication is key, as are the human-to-human skills of patience, deliberation, and discernment. Yes, if thousands of trainers equipped themselves with Google Glass and recorded all their encounters, perhaps some divine database of grimaces and rolled eyes, injuries and triumphs, could dictate the optimal response to a miserable gym goer. But even to begin imagining how to construct such a database, what gets marked as a good or bad outcome, and to what extent, is to understand the critical role people will play in constructing and maintaining a plausible future of AI and robotics. Artificial intelligence will remain artificial because it will always be a product constructed out of human cooperation. Moreover, most recent advances in AI are designed to perform specific tasks, rather than to take on entire jobs or social roles. There are many examples of technologies that make jobs more productive, more rewarding, or both. As the Agency for Digital Italy has observed, technology often does not completely replace a professional figure, but replaces only some specific activities. Contemporary law students can barely believe that pre-internet lawyers had to comb through dusty tomes to assess the validity of a case. Research software makes that process easier and vastly expands the range of resources available for an argument. Far from simplifying matters, it may make them much more complex. Spending less time hunting down books and more time doing the intellectual work of synthesizing cases is a net plus for attorneys. Automation can bring similar efficiencies to myriad other workers, without mass displacement of labor. And this is not merely an observation. This is a proper goal of policy. 2. Robotic systems and AI should not counterfeit humanity. From Asimov's time to the vertiginous mimicry of Westworld, the prospect of humanoid robots has been fascinating, frightening, and titillating. Some roboticists aspire to find the right mix of metal bones and plastic skin that can break out of the uncanny valley, the queasiness that a humanoid robot evokes when it comes very close to, but does not quite recreate, human features, gestures, and ways of being. Machine learning programs have already mastered the art of creating pictures of fake people, and convincing synthetic voices may soon become common. As engineers scramble to fine-tune these algorithms, a larger question goes unasked. Do we want to live in a world where human beings do not know whether they are dealing with a fellow human or a machine? There is a critical difference between humanizing technology and the counterfeiting of distinctively human characteristics. Leading European ethicists have argued that there have to be legal limits to the ways in which people can be led to believe that they are dealing with human beings, while in fact they are dealing with algorithms and smart machines. Lawmakers have already passed bot disclosure laws in online contexts. Despite this growing ethical consensus, there are subfields of AI, such as effective computing, which analyzes and simulates human emotion, devoted to making it more and more difficult for us to distinguish between humans and machines. These research projects might culminate in a creation like the advanced androids in the Steven Spielberg film AI, indistinguishable from a human being. Ethicists debate how such humanoid robots should be designed, but what if they should not be made at all? In hospitals, schools, police stations, and even manufacturing facilities, there is little to gain by embodying software in humanoid bodies, and plenty to lose. The race to mimic humanity might too easily become a prelude to replacing it. Some people might prefer such replacement in private life, and law should respect such autonomy in intimate realms. But the idea of a society dedicated to advancing it in workplaces, the public sphere, and beyond is madness. It confuses the abolition of humanity with its advance. This argument may jar or confound technophiles, to reject not merely the substance, but also the premise, not only of Asimov's laws, but also of a vast literature on the future of technology. I hope to justify this conservativism by thinking through, chapter by chapter, the concrete steps we would need to take to get to a science fictional world of robots indistinguishable from humans. That transition entails massive surveillance of humans, all to create robots designed to fool or allure human beings into treating machines as their equals. Neither prospect is appealing. The voice or face of another human being demands respect and concern. Machines have no such claim on our conscience. When chatbots fool the unwary into thinking that they are interacting with humans, their programmers act as counterfeiters, falsifying features of actual human existence to increase the status of their machines. When the counterfeiting of money reaches a critical mass, genuine currency loses value. Much the same fate lies in store for human relationships in societies that allow machines to freely mimic the emotions, speech, and appearance of humans. The counterfeiting of humanity is a particular danger as corporations and governments seek to put a friendly face on their services and demands. Google assistants have wowed the business press by mimicking secretaries making appointments, eerily replicating even the ums and ahs that punctuate typical phone conversations. These conversational fillers disguise the power of a firm like Google with the hesitation or deference typically expressed by a human's unpolished speech. They cloak a robocall as a human inquiry. For those on the receiving end of the calls, it is all too easy to imagine abuse, a deluge of call from robotized call centers. Counterfeiting humanity is not merely deceptive, it is also unfair, giving the counterfeiter the benefit of the appearance of personal support and interest without its reality. As we will learn in case after case of robot teachers, soldiers, customer service representatives, and more, dissatisfaction and distress at failed imitations of humanity are not merely the result of imperfect technology. Rather, they reflect wise caution about the direction of technology itself. 3. Robotic systems and AI should not intensify zero-sum arms races. Debates over killer robots are a central theater for ethics in international law. A global coalition of civil society organizations is pushing nations to pledge not to develop lethal autonomous weapon systems, laws. Several factors now stymie this commendable proposal for technological restraint. Military leaders distrust their counterparts in rival countries. They may hide militarized AI research, advancing in power even as they publicly disclaim any such intent. Rising powers may assert themselves, investing in force projection to match their new economic status, while now dominant militaries press for more resources to maintain their relative advantage. This is but one of many ways an arms race begins. As AI and robotics enter the picture, the stakes of falling behind one's rivals rise, since emerging technologies promise to be so much more targeted, ubiquitous, and rapidly deployed. Dovish politicians may commit themselves to a purely defensive posture, reflected in the United States' shift from a Department of War to a Department of Defense in 1949. But defenses can often be repurposed as offensive weapons. Think, for instance, of autonomous drones, designed to destroy missiles but reprogrammed to assassinate generals. Thus, even protective plans can seem aggressive, as in the case of Ronald Reagan's Strategic Defense Initiative, SDI. Popularly known as Star Wars, SDI would have relied on lasers in space to shoot down Soviet missiles. Had it worked, it would have upset a fragile balance of deterrence, mutually assured destruction via nuclear annihilation. Now, laws, automated cyber attacks, and disinformation campaigns threaten to disrupt long-settled expectations about the purpose and limits of international conflict. We must find new ways of limiting their development and impact. War may at first appear as a state of exception, where ordinary ethical reasoning is suspended, or at least radically circumscribed. But the third new law of robotics has applications well beyond the battlefield. Technologies pioneered by armies also tempt police departments, and more law enforcers aim to use facial recognition to scan crowds for criminals. Via machine learning, tax authorities may ferret out unreported income by parsing the email and bank accounts of all citizens. The mere possibility of such perfected surveillance will provoke the more security conscious to invest in encryption, which in turn will prod authorities to throw more resources into decryption. We need to find ways of limiting these dynamics, and not merely in military and policing scenarios. Investment in AI and robotics is often part of a contest for a fixed set of resources. For example, in litigation, finance, and other sectors where people compete for positional advantage. To allocate such resources, government and corporations set citizens and consumers in reputational competitions, such as credit scoring, whose ratings are meaningful to the extent that they stigmatize some people with low scores and elevate others with high ones. At its beginning, credit scoring was confined to one area of life, determining eligibility for loans, and based on a limited set of data, repayment history. Over decades, credit scores and similar measures have come to inform other determinations, including insurance rates and employment opportunities. More recently, data scientists have proposed more data sources for credit scoring, ranging from the way people type to their political affiliation to the types of websites they visit online. The Chinese government has also expanded the stakes of surveillance, proposing that social credit scores play a role in determining what trains or planes a citizen can board, what hotels a person can stay in, and what schools a family's children can attend. And many of its jurisdictions have expanded the data potentially included, everything from how a person crosses the street to how they treat their parents, to their degree of patriotism and loyalty to the Communist Party and its teachings. Social credit scoring and its many Western analogs have been enormously controversial, and it is unclear how far they will develop. To be sure, some applications of these systems may be quite valuable, It is hard to complain about public health surveillance that accelerates contact tracing to stop the spread of infectious disease before a pandemic starts. But when the same powerful capacities are ranking and rating everyone all the time, they become oppressive. The chief danger of social control via AI is a world of regimentation. Conflict and competition are part of life, and we should expect technological advance to inform them. But AI and robotics threaten to make social control too perfect, and competition, to be the entity capable of imposing or evading that control, too fierce. Human security and creativity thrive in environments that balance predictability and openness, order and flux. If we fail to limit robotics embedded in systems of social control, that balance will be upended. 4. Robotic systems and AI must always indicate the identity of their creators, controllers, and owners. People are responsible for robotic or algorithmic systems. True, some programs can now generate new programs, which in turn may spawn others. But we can still trace these mind children and grandchildren back to their source. We should keep this status quo for the foreseeable future, despite predictable resistance from some advocates of fully autonomous AI. The cutting edge of the AI, machine learning, and robotics fields emphasizes autonomy, whether of smart contracts, high-frequency trading algorithms, at least in time spans undetectable by humans, or future robots. There is a nebulous notion of out-of-control robots that escape their creator. Perhaps such accidents are unavoidable. Nevertheless, some person or entity should be responsible for them. A requirement that any AI or robotic system has some designated party responsible for its action would help squelch such projects, which could be just as dangerous as unregulated bioengineering of viruses. Of course, some robots and algorithms will evolve away from the ideals programmed into them by their owners as a result of interactions with other persons and machines. Think, for instance, of advanced self-driving cars that evolve as a result of multiple influences. In such cases, there may be multiple potentially responsible parties for any given machine's development and eventual actions. Whatever affects the evolution of such machines, the original creator should be obliged to build in certain constraints on the code's evolution to both record influences and prevent bad outcomes. Once another person or entity hacks or disables those constraints, the hacker is responsible for the robot's wrongdoing. For a concrete application of this principle, consider a chatbot that gradually learns certain patterns of dialogue from interactions on Twitter. According to some news accounts, Microsoft's AI chatbot, Tay, quickly adopted the speech patterns of an unhinged Nazi sympathizer after only a few hours on Twitter. Microsoft did not program that outcome, but it should have known that it was a danger of exposing a bot to a platform notorious for its poor moderation of harassment and hate speech. Moreover, to the extent that the chatbot did log where the malign influences came from, it could have reported them to Twitter, which, in some better version of itself, could have taken some action to suspend or slow the flood of abuse coming from troll accounts, and worse. Regulators will need to require responsibility by design, to complement extant models of security by design and privacy by design. That may involve requiring certain hard-coded audit logs or licensing practices that explicitly contemplate problematic outcomes. Such initiatives will not simply regulate robotics and AI post hoc, but will influence systems development by foreclosing some design options and encouraging others. Each of these new laws of robotics, promoting complementarity, authenticity, cooperation, and attribution, rests on a theme that will animate the rest of our exploration: the critical distinction between technology that replaces people and technology that helps them do their jobs better. The point of the new laws is to develop policies that capitalize on human strengths in fields such as health and education, and to take advantage of human limits to bound the scope and intensity of conflict and regimentation in social life. AI researchers have long aimed to create computers that can sense, think, and act like humans. As far back as the 1960s, roboticists at MIT were developing robot sentries to relieve soldiers of the boring and dangerous duty of standing guard at vulnerable sites. But there is another way to think about the sentry robot, not as AI replacing troops, but as one more tool to increase soldiers' effectiveness as defenders. An army does not necessarily need to requisition more soldiers to monitor emerging threats. It can instead develop sensors and computers designed to act as a second set of eyes and ears, rapidly processing threat levels and other data to better inform soldiers' actions. This goal, deemed intelligence augmentation, IA, has informed the projects of many internet pioneers. It is also a mainstay of modern warfare, as drone pilots handle a rich array of sensor data to make life and death decisions about aerial bombings. Though sometimes blurry, the distinction between AI and IA is a critical one for innovation policy. Most parents are not ready to send their children off to robot teachers, nor should their children be taught that teachers will eventually be replaced by machines perfectly personalized to their learning styles. There are many visions of robotics in education that are far more humane. For example, schools have already experimented successfully with companion robots that help young students by drilling them on vocabulary words and asking them questions about what they just learned. Looking like animals or fanciful creatures rather than people, these robots do not challenge the distinctiveness of humanity. Researchers are finding that in many contexts, IA results in better service and outcomes than either artificial or human intelligence working alone. Assistive AI and robotics could be a godsend for workers, freeing more hours for rest or leisure. But in any modern market economy, there are economic laws that tilt the scale toward AI and against IA. A robot does not demand time off, a fair wage, or health insurance. When labor is viewed primarily as a cost, its fair pay is a problem, which machines are supposed to solve. Robotics revolutionized manufacturing by replacing assembly line workers. Now, many business experts want similar technological advances to take over more complex work, from medicine to the military. Caught up in these managerialist enthusiasms, too many journalists have discussed robot lawyers and robot doctors as if they are already here. This book will explain that such descriptions are overblown. To the extent that technology transforms professions, it is tended to do so via IA, not AI. Submerging beneath breathless headlines about software eating the world, there are dozens of less spectacular instances of computation helping attorneys or doctors or educators to work faster or better. The question now for innovation policy is where to sustain this predominance of IA and where to promote AI. This is a problem we must confront sector by sector, rather than hoping to impose a one-size-fits-all model of technological advance. Conversations about robots usually tend toward the utopian: machines will do all the dirty, dangerous, or difficult work, or the dystopian, and all the rest besides, creating mass unemployment. But the future of automation in the workplace, and well beyond, will hinge on millions of small decisions about how to develop AI. How far should machines be entrusted to take over tasks once performed by humans? What is gained and lost when they do so? What is the optimal mix of robotic and human interaction? And how do various rules, from codes of professional ethics to insurance policies to statutes, influence the scope and pace of robotization in our daily lives? Answers to these questions can substantially determine whether automation promises a robot revolution or a slow, careful improvement in how work is done. Why should we be especially concerned with robots and AI, as opposed to the ubiquitous screens and software that have already colonized so much of our time? There are two practical reasons. First, the physical presence of a robot can be far more intrusive than any tablet, smartphone, or sensor. Indeed, those technologies can simply be embedded into robots. No flat screen could reach out and restrain a misbehaving child or a defiant prisoner, modifying and repurposing present technology of crowd control for new forms of discipline. But a robot could. Even if uptake of robots is slow or limited, AI threatens to supercharge the techniques of fascination and persuasion embedded into tech, ranging from mobile apps to video poker. As human-computer interaction researcher Julie Carpenter observes, "Even if you know a robot has very little autonomy, when something moves in your space and it seems to have a sense of purpose, we associate that with something having an inner awareness or goals. Even something with as little animation as a robot vacuum cleaner can provoke an emotional response. The more sensors record our reactions, the richer the veins of emotional data for more sophisticated computers to mine. Every like is a clue to what engages us. Every lingering moment on a screen is positive reinforcement for some database of manipulation. Miniaturized sensors make surveillance mobile, unraveling efforts to hide. Indeed, the decision to shield oneself from sensors may be one of the most revealing activities one can engage in. Moreover, processing capacities and data storage could put us on a path to a dystopia where everything counts and anything a student does may be recorded and backed up to inform future evaluations. By contrast, a student in an ordinary school may encounter different teachers every year, starting off with a relatively clean slate each time. None of these troubling possibilities is destined to happen, though, which raises a second reason to focus on robotics policy now. As robots enter highly regulated fields, we have a golden opportunity to shape their development with thoughtful legal standards for privacy and consumer protection. We can channel technology through law. Robots need not be designed to record every movement of those whom they accompany or supervise. Indeed, robot supervision itself could seem sufficiently oppressive that we require some human monitoring of any such system, as a robotic South Korean prison mandated for its mechanical guards. When robots are part of a penal system, a broad, rich debate on prison policy and on the relative merits of retribution and rehabilitation should inform any decision to deploy them. Indeed, one of the main points of the new laws of robotics is to warn policymakers away from framing controversies in AI and robotics as part of a blandly general technology policy, and toward deep engagement with domain experts charged with protecting important values in well-established fields. Cynics may scoff that such values are inherently subjective and that they are destined for obsolescence in an ever more technological society. But communities of scholars and consultants focused on science, technology, and human values have shown that anticipatory ethics can inform and influence technology design. Values are designed into technology. Canadian, European, and American regulators have already endorsed privacy by design as a basic principle for developers. Rules like that should apply a fortiori to sensor-laden technology, which can move freely to maximize its ability to record images and sound. For example, in the way that many video cameras have a red light indicating that they are recording, robots should feature an equivalent indicator when they record persons around them. AI-driven data should be subject to strict limits on collection, analysis, and use. Technologists may counter that it is too early to regulate robotics. Let problems develop and only then move to counter them, say the partisans of laissez-faire. But quietism misses the mark. All too often in high technology fields, industry says it is never a good time to regulate. When troubling new business practices emerge, would-be regulators are accused of strangling an infant industry. Once the practices are widespread, the very fact of their ubiquity is offered as proof that consumers accept them. For every argument offered for legal intervention, there is a pat strategy of deflection based on bromides and platitudes. Is there really a problem? Let's wait and see. And consumers want it, are all offered as all-purpose rationales for inaction, played like trump cards in a game of whist. A wait-and-see attitude ignores the ways in which technology, far from being independent of our values, comes to shape them. Robotic companions for children in online charter schools would not merely reflect or distort current values regarding what kinds of socialization are owed to the young. They would also shape those values of those generations, inculcating them with a sense of what types of moments are private and what are fair game for potentially permanent recording. These mores should not simply result from whatever is most profitable for edtech providers. They need democratic governance and input from experts well outside technology fields. This value-shaping role of technology is also a clear and present danger in warfare, where robotics could fundamentally alter what we take to be the parameters of a fair conflict. For some futurists, the automation of conflict is a foregone conclusion. No military power can afford to fall too far behind rivals that are developing a fearsome fleet of killer robots. If we are wired for war, then we are prone to escalate the development of deadly robotic force. On these accounts, human nature dictates a certain course of technological development, and perhaps its own obsolescence, in favor of superhuman robotic systems. Such realism may be prudent, but it also risks becoming a dangerously self-fulfilling prophecy, accelerating rather than predicting an arms race. The less costly military intervention appears, the more likely politicians and states are to engage in it. Moreover, the more precisely force can be deployed, the more the language of war and law enforcement starts to blur and create ethical gray areas. Consider a near-real possibility. The United States supplements its aerial drone presence in combat zones with ground-crawling robots and smaller indoor drones. Would the individuals tracked down by such robots be combatants or suspects? Both international and national legal precedents dictate different treatment for each. Such treatment cannot be readily automated, if indeed it can be automated at all. Thus, the law of war, or mere criminal procedure, may prove an insuperable barrier to robot soldiers, or at least their legitimate deployment. Both academics and government officials have already begun to analyze scenarios of robotized war and law enforcement. Expect a continuing merger of the two fields under the catch-all rubric of homeland security, and many more applications of robotics in the name of social order. The promise here is ultimately one of superhuman intelligence in threat detection. AI able to parse millions of data streams in order to quickly detect and diffuse future crime. Before anyone gets too enthusiastic about this technology, however, there are some sobering examples of just how inhuman an artificial intelligence can be. Researchers have used machine learning to predict criminality from little more than a person's face. Should future police robots include this facial criminality data as they make decisions about which individuals to follow more closely and which to ignore? Are any data or inferences off limits to machines that may be an increasing part of law enforcement in the future, such as the predictive analytics now popular in some police departments? Do we have the right to inspect and dispute such data? Should such research even be done at all? Correlating facial features with criminality may seem like an exotic or unusual application of AI, but the underlying logic of much advanced computation remains impenetrable to ordinary forms of explanation. Some roboticists celebrate inexplicability as an alternative to, or even advance beyond, human intelligence. At some point, it's like explaining Shakespeare to a dog, Columbia University's Hod Lipson remarked after being asked to assess demands for more transparent AI systems. When it comes to killing cancer cells or predicting the weather, Lipson may have a point. We do not need to understand the exact mechanism of an AI in order to empower it to solve our problems. But when it comes to important decisions about people, the inexplicable is inappropriate. As the European Union's emerging right to an explanation shows, it can be limited and replaced with a more humane approach. Some of the biggest battles over robotics and AI will focus on the analytic power of machines. What data are they allowed to gather and use? And how will those data be processed? These questions are of vital importance to the future of democracy and communications. Think about how misinformation flourishes. While biased propaganda has long haunted the media, a largely automated public sphere has supercharged it, enabling outright falsehoods and fabrications to spread virally. Some authorities have now begun to intervene, damping the spread of hate speech and falsehoods. That is a first step toward repairing the online public sphere, but much more will be required, including a more prominent role for journalists who abide by traditional norms of their profession. Cyber libertarians will argue that their AIs should enjoy a freedom to think that includes the processing of any data they come across or that their owners want to feed them. In the realm of pure computing unconnected to social consequences, that right might be respected. All manner of irresponsible speech is permitted in the name of free expression. Software programmers can assert a similar right to enter data into programs without regard to its social consequences. But as soon as algorithms, and especially robotics, have effects in the world, they must be regulated, and their programmers subject to ethical and legal responsibility for the harms they cause. Professionalism and expertise. Who gets to decide what this responsibility entails? A smooth and just transition will demand both old and new forms of professionalism in several key areas. The concept of expertise commonly connotes a mastery of a certain body of information, but its actual exercise involves much more. For those who conflate occupational duties with mere knowledge, the future of employment looks grim. Computers' capacity to store and process information has expanded exponentially, and more data about what individuals do during their workday is constantly accumulating. But professionalism involves something more complex, a recurrent need to deal with conflicts of values and duties, and even conflicting accounts of facts. That makes a difference to the future of work. For example, imagine that you are driving down a two-lane road at 45 miles per hour, cruising home. You see a group of children walking home from school about 100 yards ahead. Just as you are about to pass by them, an oncoming 18-wheeler swerves out of its lane and is about to hit you head-on. You have seconds to decide. Sacrifice yourself, or hit the children so you can avoid the truck. I like to think that most people would choose the nobler option. The automation of driving advances, such as self-sacrificial values, can be coded into vehicles. Many cars already detect whether a toddler in a driveway is about to be run over by a driver with a blind spot. They even beep when other vehicles are in danger of being bumped. Transitioning from an alert system to a hardwired stop is technically possible. And if that is possible, so is an automatic brake that would prevent a driver from swerving for self-preservation at the expense of many others. But the decision can also be coded the other way, to put the car occupant's interests above all others. Although I do not think that that is the correct approach, the correctness of the approach is beside the point for our purposes. The labor question addresses how engineers, regulators, and marketers, as well as government relations and sales professionals, work together to shape human-computer interactions that respect the interests of everyone affected by automation, while also respecting commercial imperatives. There are few one-shot problems in design, marketing, and safety. As technology advances, users adapt, markets change, and new demands are constantly arising. The medical profession has long been faced with such dilemmas. Doctors' jobs are never limited to merely taking care of the cases before them. Obliged to understand and monitor risks and opportunities that are constantly shifting, doctors must keep track of where medicine is headed, staying current about studies that either confirm or question mainstream medical knowledge. Consider even a decision as trivial as whether to give an antibiotic to a patient with a sinus infection. A good primary care doctor must first decide whether the drug is clinically indicated. Doctors may take subtly different positions on how robust their obligation is to conserve antibiotic prescriptions to slow the evolution of resistant microbes. They also need to keep track of the prevalence of potential side effects of antibiotics, such as the sometimes devastating infections caused by Clostridium difficile, and the varying likelihood of such effects on different types of patients. Patients have some awareness of all these things when they visit a physician, but they are not responsible for coming to a correct decision or melding all these judgment calls into a recommendation for a particular case. That is the professional's role. For true believers in the all-encompassing power of big data, predictive analytics, algorithms, and AI, the brains of robots, can hack their way around all these problems. This is a tempting vision, promising exponential technological progress to raise living standards. But is it a realistic one? Even systems based purely in the digital realm, such as search engine algorithms, high-frequency trading, and targeted advertising, have proven in numerous cases to be biased, unfair, inaccurate, or inefficient. Information is much harder to capture accurately in the wild, and there are disputes over what should be measured in the first place. Stakes rise considerably higher when algorithmic systems are empowered as the brains of robots that can sense their environment and act upon it. Meaningful human control is essential. Nor is such human control only necessary in fields such as medicine, which has a long history of professional self-governance. Even in transport, professionals will have critical roles for decades to come. However fast robotic driving advances, the firms developing it cannot automate the social acceptance of delivery drones, sidewalk wagons, or cars. As legal expert Bryant Smith has observed, lawyers, marketers, civil engineers, and legislators must all help prepare society as a whole for the widespread development of such technologies. Governments need to change their procurement policies, both for vehicles and infrastructure. Local communities must make difficult decisions about how to manage the transition, since stoplights and other road features optimized for human drivers may not work well for robotic vehicles, and vice versa. As Smith observes, long-term assumptions should be revisited for land use plans, infrastructure projects, building codes, bonds, and budgets. The labor required for such a transition will be vast and diverse. Security experts will model whether vehicles without human passengers pose special risks to critical infrastructure or to crowds. Terrorists do not need to recruit a suicide bomber if they can load a self-driving car with explosives. Public health experts will model the spread of infectious disease if such vehicles include strangers. Legislators are already grappling with the question of whether to require such vehicles to revert control to a person upon request, or to give that control to police when they demand it. I use the ambiguous term person in the last sentence because we still do not have a good term for occupants of a semi-autonomous vehicle. Both law and norms will shape that new identity over time. None of these decisions should be made solely, or even predominantly, by the programmers and corporations developing algorithms for self-driving cars. They involve governance and participation by a much wider range of experts, ranging from urban studies scholars to regulators to police and attorneys. Negotiations among affected parties are likely to be protracted, but that is the price of a democratic and inclusive transition toward new and better technology. And these are only a few of the ethical, legal, and social implications of a widespread transition to self-driving cars. Nevertheless, some futurists argue that AI obviates the need for professions. With a large enough set of training data, they argue, virtually any human function can be replaced with a robot. This book takes the exact opposite view. To the extent our daily lives are shaped by AI and machine learning, often run by distant and massive corporations, we need more and better professionals. That is a matter of affirming and extending the patterns of education and licensure we already have in fields like medicine and law. And it may require building entirely new professional identities in other critical sectors where both wide public participation and expertise are essential. Two crises of expertise. Asserting humans' value as a form of expertise may be jarring to some. At present, the most popular argument against AI's encroachment on the governance of workplaces and cities is a democratic appeal. AI's critics argue that technical experts in topics like machine learning and neural networks are not diverse enough to represent the persons their technology affects. They are too removed from local communities. The same could be said of many other experts. There is a long and distinguished history of activists complaining about aloof doctors and professors, incomprehensible lawyers, and scientists detached from the quotidian problems of every man. Confronted about economists' predictions of disastrous consequences from Brexit, British politician Michael Gove asserted that people in this country have had enough of experts. As that sentiment fuels populist campaigns around the world, there is a deepening chasm between politics and expertise, mass movements and bureaucratic acumen, popular will, and elite reasoning. Commenting on such trends, the sociologist Gil Eyal argues that expertise is a way of talking about the intersection, articulation, and friction between science and technology on the one hand, and law and democratic politics on the other. This is indeed a venerable tension in administration, where bureaucrats must often make difficult decisions implicating both facts and values. For example, raising or reducing pollution limits is a decision with medical consequences for the incidence of lung cancer, economic impact on the profitability of enterprise, and even cultural significance for the viability of, say, mining communities. Eyal focuses on a democratic challenge to pure technocratic decision-making on each of those fronts. This book examines a different and distinct challenge to expertise, or more precisely, a clash of forms of expertise. Well-credentialed economists and AI experts have asserted that their ways of knowing and ordering the world should take priority almost everywhere, from hospitals to schools, central banks to war rooms. Few are as blunt as a former technology company CEO who remarked to a general, "You absolutely suck at machine learning. If I got under your tent for a day, I could solve most of your problems." But the general theme of many books on AI-driven automation and economic disruption is that the methods of economics and computer science are primus inter pares among other forms of expertise. They predict and help enact a world where AI and robotics rapidly replace human labor, as economics dictates cheaper methods of getting jobs done. On this view, nearly all workers will eventually share the fate of elevator operators and horse and buggy drivers, just waiting until someone with adequate data, algorithms, and machinery replaces us. To be sure, there are areas where economics and AI are essential. A business cannot run without covering its costs. A self-checkout lane will fail if its scanner program cannot recognize product barcodes. But the questions of whether a business should exist, or a cashier should be replaced with a robotic kiosk, cannot be answered by economics or computer science alone. Politicians, communities, and businesses decide based on complex sets of values and demands. These values and demands cannot simply be reduced to equations of efficiency and algorithms of optimization entirely distinct and abstracted from communities. Rather, they are expressed and reconciled by human experts, either in current or future professions capable of demonstrating how their workers and managers intimate, local knowledge results in services of practices worth preserving. To pursue the opposite, unleashing commercial pressures and robotic mimicry to colonize, replace, and rule every form of human labor is to radically reorganize society. The sociologist Will Davis once observed that a profession that claimed jurisdiction over everything would no longer be a profession, but a form of epistemological tyranny. Today, far too many discussions of AI.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.